things. I want to like check in with people. I want to make sure you're doing good. Mm-hmm. But that also means that it's taking energy from me. And I want to make sure that it's reciprocated as like, what are we doing? So I have a hierarchy of friends. Do you do this where like I have my inner circle? So people are ride or die. I trust. I'll tell them whatever they need to know.
Yeah.
And then people who are like my social circles, people I kind of know, like maybe I talk to them offline or maybe like I go visit them. And then there's like everybody else in the world that I like,
I love.
And I will see and I'll, but you know what I mean? It's just people.
Yeah.
So like you do this in your life, yes?
Yeah, for sure.
Okay.
I have like a few people that's like way more important. Well, like not important, but like I definitely feel like I have like a connection with them more and they're important. And I know that they, I could always turn to this person and say like, hey, let's go to this thing. Like, let's do that together. And they enjoy those sort of things. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. Or like,
and I then call there's them... some people that I could have a lunch with and I can chat with them about whatever. And it's just kind of like fun. You know?
Yes. Okay. Exactly.
But I do value them too. I value those people too. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing is like, look, I value every good interaction and I value like, even when I go to fucking Walmart, girl, like people be coming up to me and like sharing their life story with me. And I'm like, oh, okay, we're doing this now. It's like, oh, this stranger who doesn't know me for some reason felt the need to come to me and just tell me about their day. And so like, I will, how was your day? And like, we'll have this moment together and then I'll finish getting my milk and then go home. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. But like sometimes even those moments happen, but those moments can't be nearly as important to me as like the moments I'm having with my siblings. Like those moments are important because I'm like, my brother lives here and he's got kids. He lives 30 minutes from me and he brings the kids over once a week now. It was 3 days a week, girl, but I just got demoted to one because, you know, that actually they do jiu-jitsu together, my brother and his wife.
Really?
And she it's so great. Well, I told them, I was like, if you guys are going to do couples jiu-jitsu, I will watch the kids until you guys get pregnant because that's what I was waiting for. And then she just announced. So I'm really excited.
Oh my God,
I love babies. And so like it just got me so I'm down to once a week. But even then, I try to think like I remember one of my viewers asked me, she goes, oh, are you working less to hang out with your nephews? I was like, girl, I will always pass up money for family because for me, like these are the moments that's gonna matter the most to me when I'm 90 years old. Like these are the kids. I want these kids to know Auntie Brittany is amazing. Auntie Brittany has the cool house. Auntie Brittany, you know, we want to build memories, but to make that decision is to get out of that hustle and grind. Is to move away from surviving your life and living your existence and actually having those moments. But it's so hard with adults. Because weirdly enough, adults are so much more jealous and overthinking than children. They just overthink everything and they don't let the moment happen. And at the same time, I kind of feel like we have to plan. So I wanted to ask you if you could kind of dive into that idea of like you keep saying, or like I've heard Steven say it too, like people use Melina to get to me or people use him to get to you.
Uh-huh.
Why, when you guys are both so successful on your own, would they need to go through the other one?
That's a good question. It's very weird. I don't know why they do this. It's super, super strange. I think they're just assuming things. I don't think they understand what it feels like to be us and being like really chill and like very like open-minded. I don't think they know what it feels like. And I don't think they met people like that. So they probably just feel like they have to do some sort of like game to get something or do something. But, like, I feel like me and Steve, we see through it pretty quick.
Yeah.
We're not, like, it's pretty easy to just see, like, what's going on.
Oh, yeah.
And it could also be the case sometimes that they don't really mean any harm, but they feel like this is the way to go. So something, this is so weird. And I don't think they mean anything bad. And if they're listening, that's okay. But sometimes I notice, and I ask Steven this, hey, have you talked to this person recently? And he's like, oh, not that much, really. I've been very busy. And I'm like, yeah, that makes sense because they just contacted me. So sometimes I realize when he's not paying attention to them, I think they're trying to find some sort of like relationship with me. And I'm not sure if it's because they want to get close to him or if they're just saying like, or just thinking like, maybe I need to be her friend so he will like me more, but I'm also interested in her. Or if they're just thinking like, oh, he's bored of me and she's dating him, so she must be a little similar, so I'm going to talk to her instead.
Totally.
I had 3 people that he's been talking with for some of them like years, and they were all like during a week in my chat at this, like, you know, through a whole week, they were all there.
Okay.
But it was because that specific week he was not very social with them and they all just came to me and I was like,
what?
What is going on here? I'm curious what's going on. But I don't think they mean anything bad or anything. I think they're like, I want to think that they're legit interested in me. But I can see what's going on. Like, I can tell, like, okay, I know that he is having a phase right now where he's not showing as much attention because he's busy doing something. But it's like, that's whatever. I don't see it as a bad thing. I'm not going to be like, never like that. But I can see what's happening. And I think this is just like people's minds of like, and if I want to like do this, or if I want to like be a part of this, like I want to be a part of this thing, I need to like put myself in there a little bit more. So they're going to come to me and talk. And I'm like, I'm fine with it. I enjoy talking to people, but I know I'm always, and I tell them, I'm going to have my guard up until I spend enough time with you to see who you are.
Because
I
don't really know what your intention is. As you should. Yeah. Yes, that idea that you wouldn't is so outrageous to me that it makes me want to go to everyone and slap like a wall on them. Have your wall up, just a little wall, guys. Uh-huh. Just like a little.
But it
one.
Could also. But I'm also aware that it could look like I'm like possessive, or that I'm like jealous, or that I'm just don't want them in my life, or that I don't want them to talk to Steve. It could look that way when I do that, but it's honestly just to protect myself. I really like. They asked me to like, would you ever have like a third person living with you? And I think. It sounds like just thinking about this sounds like so much fun, but I know that's going to be a fuck ton of work.
Yeah, right? It is, girl.
Like, the good thing sounds really good. Like, yeah, like having a girl like that just lives here that I could hang out with like more than Steven or whatever. That sounds great. Like having someone there all the time that I can do fun stuff with.
Yeah.
And I'm very, very horny. And Steven gets so busy that he kind of like works instead of having sex. So I know I'm more like sexually driven than he is.
His priorities are bad.
Yeah. Exactly. So if someone, is more like that to me, that would be great. But I know that like having three people and everyone needs to be pleased and get what they want. And like if one person is not giving as much as the other one and you know, like that's going to be a mess.
Yes.
For sure.
Yes.
So you really need everyone to be able to like understand. And like, it's not going to be easy. It's going to be really hard to do that. Even though it sounds like so much fun, it's going to be a lot of work.
Absolutely is.
Yeah, but like the idea of it sounds great. But I think a lot of people, especially that he talks to, not for me really, usually the people that I talk to kind of like want to stay away from him.
Mm-hmm.
They really try to go in with the idea that they could like be some sort of like three thing, I think. A lot of them have that mentality.
I thought you guys weren't open to that.
I think why we say that we have an open relationship is usually because like... I think we have a very limited amount of time. I think I have more time for people than he has. But he knows that he can't give a lot of time. If he spends 2 days with someone and he's talking to them, I think a lot of people might see that as like, he has to be this way all the time.
Yeah.
But he is like this like twice a year.
Yeah.
Like, he's not like this all the time. He's very, very different when he's himself working like daily life sort of stuff. Like he barely talks to anyone. He's just like streaming all the time.
Yeah.
Like we don't even really talk that much. But if he goes to see someone and he's spending a lot of time and making them feel like it's center of attention, it's not him. That's just like vacation. You know, that's not real. It's not school and work and like real life stuff. It's just fun.
I feel like that's streamer life though. Isn't that like YouTube life too? I feel like Because I know for a fact, like, I'm already pre-planning, like, in my head, I want to travel for the summer, and I want to see people, and I'm like, how do I want to see people? And I travel solo, and I travel the backpack, and I usually go, look, I'm going to be here and here. If you're there, great. If you're not, oh well. But, like, it's one of those things where, like,
if you get a little bit of time, be good for that, because I will be busy, but if you get a little bit of time, just, like, don't expect anything. Yeah.
Right. Unless I specifically really want to see someone, then I'm like, hey, I need to see you, so give me two of your days of your time. Like, just two, because I know people work, and I know people are busy. Mm-hmm. But, like, just to get that would be great. But that is, even for me, like, a vacation. I think it's streamer life because I can't even – this job is, like, you can make money and save it, but you also have to stay consistent. So it doesn't allow me a lot of time to travel unless I'm making traveling a part of the job, which I guess you get the luxury of. So smart. Like, that's what you get. Like, that's so cool. So do you actually, like, travel on your own, by the way? Like, now, like, even currently, do you, like, leave? Like, you said you were in Sweden, I think.
I was in Sweden in October. I can't leave right now. I can like move around the US, but I'm waiting for my green card, and until then I can't leave the States.
Oh, okay, so you're chilling.
But otherwise, yeah, last summer I think it was in like 5 countries alone.
Woo!
I would have someone pop by sometimes. Like I'd be like, hey, you can come like hang out and like you can like come join me, and people would like fly out and join me for a few days. How but cool. I would kinda like do my own thing. But whenever someone is like, oh, I wanna join, I'm like, okay, let's go, you know?
That's so nice.
I do that. Yeah. I really do like traveling alone. Traveling alone feels really, really nice for me.
Yeah.
Because you get to really feel the place and feel the energy of like the cities or the small little towns or the nature that you see. And you kind of like just really feel all of that. And it feels really nice to do that with yourself.
Yeah. Okay, wait.
Listening to music.
Is traveling, because, okay, how I, okay, I do prefer to be by myself because, again, I feel like I can be my most authentic self by myself. Mm-hmm. Same mm-hmm. with when I even do drugs. Like, I do prefer drugs by myself even because I notice I just move way too much off people's energies. And mm-hmm. I'm usually trying to adapt so I'm not overwhelming because I hear a lot of feedback from people in my life that say, like, you're overwhelming. Like, hey, you're, like, taking up too much space, or, like, hey, you're, like, dragging me into your bubble. And I'm like, I know. And, like, I do have a habit of, like, grabbing people and be like, come here, I want to show you something. But mm-hmm. like, not everyone wants to do it, so I do better mm-hmm. by myself. Is drugs and traveling sort of similar for you, or do you prefer to ultimately do it with someone, or where are you at with that? What do you think, like, in relation to the other?
Okay, so if I'm thinking about traveling, I think I can handle myself traveling alone. I think that's fine. I can have, like, breakdowns alone. I can do that stuff. That's fine. Because you're happy and you're sad. Like, you do that sort of stuff. That's fine. Usually with like, psychedelic drugs, I haven't really had that much experience with it alone. And I think it's because I think I'm judging myself and being a little too young for it. Like, I'm not really sure if I'm super ready to, like, I think I am probably, but I just haven't, like, gotten that time to, like, actually feel like, okay, now is the time to do it, I think.
Fair. Fair.
But that's just, like, the feeling. It might just, maybe I should just do it, you know? I could probably just do that too, but I feel like I need to, like, know that I'm, like, in a mental, you know, setting that is just, like, I am very prepared and present with what I'm doing right now.
Okay, hold on. I'm going to challenge you a little bit, though, girl. Uh-huh. Because didn't you say earlier that you like to experience even bad stuff, good stuff?
Yes.
So.
But it could be the case of, like, if I'm going to experience this one thing and I'm just, like, thinking about some random person that I hooked up with and it's just, like, on my mind, you know, all the time. Do I really go into that, like, thinking about that person and not, like, think about something that is, like, I know what's more important. I know that I can have feelings that doesn't really mean anything and it's just
yes.
there.
Yes.
And it's Ooh. Fun, but it's, like, it's a little bit of, like, not waste of time, but it's, like, I feel like I'm, like, acting like I'm fucking in high school. Like, don't act like a fucking high schooler thinking about things that's just stupid. Like, well, not stupid, but, like, it's kind of, like, I feel like when you're younger, you're wasting a lot of time thinking about things that actually doesn't mean a lot. And then you think back on yourself when you were a teenager and you had all this, like, really, really important stuff around you, but you weren't, like, you couldn't see it because you were distracted.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So, like, something that I've been thinking about, like, lately, actually, I realized that I never got to grieve for my cat, like, when I was a kid. And my cat was very important to me. And then you become a teenager and you start seeing boys and girls.
Yeah.
And that's, like, all that was on my mind. So I forgot about my cat completely. And totally. Then now that I'm older, I realized, wait, this cat was so important. And I never got to, like, really be present with that because I didn't know how to do that because I had all this other stuff going on in my mind.
Yeah.
That was
yeah,
not
yeah.
really that. It was important in its own way, but I forgot about, like, some stuff that I'm like, I would love to get that back again, but I can't, sort of thing. So when I do a psychedelic trip, it's kind of, like, a little bit similar that I want to feel like I'm very, like, prepared of, like, these are the things that that is important to me right now. And I need to recognize that. And I need to, like, collect myself together mm-hmm. because I see it as a therapy session.
Oh, okay.
It's yeah. not just like I take a drug and it's like a party. Like, I can right. do that. But sometimes I really feel like, especially when I'm also, like, tripping with people, they want to navigate it towards, like, a fun party time or, like, yes. this is a date on drugs.
Right.
And then I realize when I'm sitting there with them that I'm like, my mind just wants to be alone right now and think about all the things that I need to think about that is, like, therapeutic to me. But I have to, like, take care of this person now, right?
Yes.
But I'm also feeling like I might need someone there with me just to check on me or as a tool to, like, climb in my thoughts, right? I need, like, a back and forth, and it doesn't even have to be much. It could just be someone asking me very, very basic, simple questions about what I'm thinking about. So I kind of need that a little bit,
mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
it's really hard to find someone like that because usually when I trip with someone, they want to make it about themselves, right?
Yeah,
and it's never really about me. But I could probably trip alone. That's something that I have thought about. I just haven't really made time for it, I guess.
What does alone mean? Mm-hmm. Does that mean, like, Steven can be in another room or, yeah. like, so, like, mm-hmm. you've never even, like, wait, you've never even I'm trying to figure this out because I spent a lot of time alone. I had the best ego death of my life in the middle of a national forest in the States. Like, no electricity, no light pollution, no cell phone reception. And I was so fucking baked, girl. And it scared the fuck out of me. But then I was like, oh my God, I'm dust. I'm literally nothing. A bear's going to come and eat me. And then I was like, calm down. If a bear eats me, at least I fed something today. Okay. It was nice. Yeah. It was like kind of nice. But I will tell you, it is very scary. But can I kind of like... Not to be such a sadist, but I kind of want to make you do it anyway. Like, I want to, like, almost, like, make you do all the drugs, like, by yourself. Uh-huh. It is so powerful. Because, like, you really look at yourself in a way where you're like, fuck, there's no one here to save me. There's no one here to rescue me. There is no one here to, like, help guide me. I have to do it myself. Are you afraid of what you might see or realize about yourself? Are you afraid that you might die of the overdose or something?
No, I think, no. It's not like that at all. I think it's just, like, it's a good question. I think it's just like a fear that doesn't really actually make sense. Or like it makes sense, but it doesn't make sense. Like I could give explanations of why I would be scared, but it actually doesn't really matter. Right. I don't think so.
Or is that where the answer is? I don't know. Maybe it does matter.
No, I think it's just, how do I say? I love to do an activity and I start like reading into the activity and like almost as like a psychedelic trip. So when I do jujitsu and I'm about to do something to them that I know like this could work. I could get them to like, I could submit them in this, but I'm too scared to do it because I'm thinking, what if that person is doing something to me at the same time that makes me lose? Right. So instead of just like doing it and see what happens, sometimes I could just sit there and wait. And then they do it instead, right? And then I defend. So I think I'm more of like a defend person. Someone does something and I defend I go with it and then I go on my road there. So people kind of like not decide what I want to do, but usually I kind of like someone gives me an idea and I go do it and I do my own thing in it. But it's rare that I'm just like, today I'm going to do a mushroom trip alone at a high dose and just sit there. I think that's a little rare because I'm having like not really actually fears that make sense. It's just like, I don't take that step of like diving. Like I don't do that one thing. I wait for someone to like push me and then I do it.
I want to know the why. I want to know why.
Yeah, good question. Don't know.
Yeah.
I don't think I know that about myself, actually. I don't think I know. As I said, I think people are a good way to climb.
Yeah. Interesting.
Kind of. Because you kind of like, you're around people and then you start learning things about yourself through others.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. But I don't think I probably just haven't had time enough to do it.
Time is needed.
I've had other stuff.
Time is like definitely needed.
Yeah. And I'll say that like I'm like young, right? And I definitely do have some fears for sure. I'm a little scared of going crazy. I think that's one thing too. I don't think a mushroom trip is going to make me go crazy, but I think I'm a little scared of having the experience of feeling crazy.
Absolutely.
And I know that probably could happen. Very likely.
100% could happen, girl.
So I would have to accept that part. But that is very scary to me, I think.
Yes, it is, as it should be. Mm-hmm. Like, that's, okay, my buddy a couple years ago, or like a year and a half ago or whatever, they, during the height of COVID, went straight, like, just no water, no food, isolated in their room, was super paranoid about everything, and got high every day off weed. Just weed, girl. Just like a vape pen weed. And then they underwent psychosis. Like, have you ever seen anyone, or have you yourself ever like undergone psychosis where you start like seeing things that aren't there? You're awake, but like nothing's making sense. You've like completely lost like reality.
Feeling things doesn't make sense, and you just like have a moment.
Sober
where
or
you
on
have
drugs?
No idea what's going on.
Sober or on drugs?
After I've done drugs, I'm sober.
Interesting.
So it affects me afterwards too. Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting. Because like there is that reality where like you could really like fuck with the chemistry in your brain, and then all of a sudden like I did DMT a while back, and I'm afraid to do it again. But I really want to, but I'm afraid because when I did it, I was like in this dance hall with these like Aztec gods, and they were like all over my body, just like pulling me and touching me. And they're like, I can't wait to dance with you forever. And I was like, ooh, this feels like I'm going to die. Like, it feels like I'm going to die in this dance club and I'm going to die of hedonism. And I hate the idea of just being pleasurable and I want to poetically suffer, but I also don't want to be like theatrical about it. I want to feel something and change. I want to be a different person after something. Mm-hmm. But when you do that, it's scary because you don't know what you'll be after, a crazy person or an enlightened person.
Yeah. And that, like, is it, and like, am I happy then with where I am? Or is it like, do I need a little bit more time to like figure things out and like be a little bit more confident in going crazy?
Yeah.
Because I need to accept that. I think I'm more scared of going crazy than dying.
Yeah, for sure. Oh, 100%. Yeah, well, I mean, it's worse than death because you exist, but you don't exist.
Exactly.
It's like,
it's very terrifying. Yeah.
It's scary. And,
I have one person, my uncle went crazy. We don't really know why. We think that he either like took a bunch of drugs when he was in America or that he joined a cult.
Oh, shit.
He got back home and he was never the same.
Really?
And like for 10 years, he was crazy. Yeah.
10 years until he passed or 10 years and then he got better?
He passed away because he escaped the mental hospital that he was at. He escaped it and then he walked out on ice and fell through like in the winter and then he died. Yeah.
Khabibi. So
like, and I think that's like, I'm probably a little scared of that. And I think also like this doesn't have to mean anything, but me and him are very similar. And that is also like, it is like a little bit of a fear for me, even though it might not be anything, you know, but we write the same way. We're into the same stuff. He was drawing and painting. I'm doing the same thing.
Oh, great.
Traveling, like being interested in the same stuff, the same music, everything. So it makes me a little like, what if I go a little bit too far? That's why I think I take a lot of things like with a grain of salt. I try to always like not ever, ever, ever trust or believe fully that what anyone says ever. Because I know that they are most likely diving right into it because they're not scared to. And I think they're closing themselves off from a lot of other stuff, right? So when someone is like trying to convince me of like a fear of life or something is the way it's supposed to be, or they're trying to talk to me, I am always taking a huge distance from that. Like, and I'm just like, okay, that's just like how they are, but I will never try to like trust or like dive right into what they're doing, and it protects me a lot, you know.
Have you ever so there's like the survival part of your brain that's being reasonable, and it's like, hey, I have to block myself off so I don't fall into this like idea of your reality. And at the same time, have you ever experimented with like, okay, I'm gonna full-on pretend I'm like in this with you, or slash do it with you, like really be open? Like I did that a lot with like religions. Like I'd be like, okay, I'm gonna do this, let's go, we believe Jesus, like, you know, trying, and I'm like, it's not working. But like, have you ever done that with someone's like reality or their own bubble?
I've like joined people to like go do stuff, but I'm never like trying to convince myself that they are right. No. And usually what happens is that they tell me more and more stuff, and then I just like take more and more distance because it doesn't make sense.
Do you ever say that to them? Do you ever say that to them? Like, this doesn't make sense? Or do you just let them go for it?
Yeah, I'm just like, this doesn't. Yeah, I usually say like, no, I don't believe in this. And they kind of get like, what? Like they almost take offense to it as well, because they're so emotionally connected and their whole personality is this. And I'm just like,
Bubbles, girl, hanging out
with you. But yeah, but like, this is, I'm never gonna like be this way. So
yeah.
Yeah, especially like hanging out with hippies, because they can start talking about stuff. And I'm just like, yeah, okay. But, and then they ask me, what do you think? I'm like, well, this does not make sense to me. And I have another theory that makes more sense to me, but I don't fully believe that either. And they just think like, why would you not believe that? And I'm like, because you can't do that, because you're closing yourself off to other things if you do, if you're so convinced on one thing. And usually when I meet people like that, I get a little scared, because I don't know, it's almost like I see, like, that's my nightmare. I do not want to be that person doing that, you know?
Oh, Melina, yes. I love your brain, girl. I love it. It's so good. Okay, well, yeah. I didn't want me to cut you off either. I know you were going to go into a story about a guy you dated.
Yeah, I dated a guy, and we had, like, insane, like, super, super good connection. We had sex, like, 10 times a day. Mm. It was just, like, we were talking. It was just so much fun. It was great. This was a few years ago. I don't remember. Maybe it wasn't that good. But I remember that I felt like this is, like, just insane.
Yeah.
But then he could, like, he would be very like spiritual, and he would start talking about us like being connected. We must have known each other in another life. Like he was doing that sort of stuff, and it sounds very romantic. And I kind of liked that idea. And I remember that I was not being like super careful with like information like that when I was younger. So I was just kind of like, oh yeah, that sounds really, really nice. But then I realized that he started like abusing that. So there was one time, and it was like really weird. It was very, very like, and I think this is probably the moment where I just started feeling like I need to take distance from people and not believe like what they're saying, because they could be very manipulative. I somehow, at some point, I logged in on my Facebook through his computer, and I went away, and I was traveling around in New Zealand because this guy was from New Zealand. And he messages me and asks me, do you send the same pictures to other people that you sent to me? Like nudes, whatever. And I said, well, maybe sometimes, but most of the time not. Like most of the time I have like different pictures.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, oh, like, are you sure? And I'm like, I think so. Like, I just said, like, my honest, like, maybe sometimes, but I don't know. Most of the time, no. And he's like, well, I know that you're, if you're lying to me, I know, because we are spiritually connected, remember?
Ugh.
So he would start saying, like, yeah, I'm connected. I can feel that you're lying to me. And, you could, like, I can feel that you're doing it. I'm like, no, I'm not, like, lying to you.
Yep.
I'm being fully
mm-hmm.
honest.
Mm-hmm.
And then he shows me a picture of him being logged into my Facebook, like reading through all of my conversations with people. And he was basically trying to like tell me that we're spiritually connected, and this is why he knows.
Yes.
Like it was just really manipulated. And when he did that, I was just like, I will never fucking ever, ever, ever listen to someone that is spiritual telling me that we're connected or something like that. It's just
same girl.
Like, mm-mm. Because a lot of people do this to try to get something or have some sort of image, or it's just like really, really, really weird.
It's the performativeness.
So meeting a lot of people doing that. Mm-hmm. But a lot of people do this. A lot of people that are spiritual or doing drugs kind of see themselves that way, or that they're trying to like use their like power of knowledge about this sort of stuff. It's very, yeah. So they're still human, even though they're doing psychedelics. They're still like a human doing like shady things, you know?
Yes. Oh, that's okay. So like the key, okay, I always say like you said earlier, drugs can be party drugs. They can be introspective drugs. They could be therapy drugs. They could be sex drugs. They could, depending on how you utilize this source, this tool.
It's a tool, yeah.
Oh, and these gimmicks, I dated a guy in my last relationship where like same chemistry was insane. Like I cannot explain to people, like the smell of his skin drove me crazy. Like I just wanted to like be consumed, and like vice versa. It was like such a mess, but it was really, really good in so many ways. And like one of the things he believed in was like a God. I don't believe in God. And he would, when we would fight or things would go wrong, he'd be like, but it's okay, cause God brought us together and we're like meant to be together. And I was like, ooh, see, you're fucking with my sense of reality, sir. So like, I hear you. I believe you believe that. But I don't believe that. So when there's problems, I need us to solve them instead of going, well, we're connected. So I'm like, okay, that's not, we might be connected, bitch, but we also yelling at each other at 3 a.m. We're trash. Like, what are we doing?
Uh-huh.
You know, it's like we're being trashy, and I don't want to be a trashy couple. Like, I don't, that's not how I was raised. That's not like my parents. Like, my parents are very loving towards each other. They do not, you know what I mean? So it's so interesting when that happens. I think it's layered, girl. Like, so I'll tell myself, okay, Brittany, like, I'm really excited to meet this person. They're beautiful. I'm like obsessed. And then it's like, wait, are we obsessed with like the chemistry? Are we obsessed with the things we have in common? Like, what is the reason I feel drawn to this person? And like, I always want to make sure it's balanced, but I have to ask myself the question, why are we attracted to this person? And if it's like for anything negative, I try to re-examine. But then can I tell you, girl, because like I'm gay this way. There's a part of the gay culture where we really like toxicity, like where we see someone who's like kind of creepy and we're like, oh, I kind of want to sleep with a serial killer, hold on, let me think about this, like, can I, like, you know, but yeah. You know.
Oh, for sure.
Do you relate to that? Is that like familiar to you? Like, you ever see someone, you're like, I should not fuck with this, but I kind of want to fuck with this a little bit?
Yes, I think I do that quite a bit.
What do you do?
I think so.
What do you do?
But
in those situations?
I think it's because you're looking for a challenge, right?
Yes.
A little bit.
Yes.
You're looking for a challenge, and it's really fun, and it's kind of like, this is a bad idea, but I'm gonna dive right into it anyways. And I'm gonna end up getting really hurt. Something bad is gonna happen, but I'm gonna survive it, and then I will have the experience of it, I guess. It's kind of like that.
Yes, it goes back to that masochism at the start of this conversation, girl. Like that challenge, that want, that the desire to like know you're not staying stagnant, and also the desire to feel like really alive. Like my days, my life is happy, girl. Like, I'm chilling, you know. Mm-hmm. I figured out what I needed to figure out for myself. I'm on my side quest now. This is what I like to mm-hmm. say. Like, I'm doing the things that I now just want to do. Like, they're not mm-hmm. needed. And I do them because, like, they fulfill me and this is what I want to do with my time. But, like, one of the parts of me, this is why I do hate being a public figure, sort of. Like, because mm-hmm. I know I'm small. I'm so small, girl, and I like it that way. Keep me small forever, please. If the goddess is listening, mm-hmm. do not let me get famous. Like, I mm-hmm. tell her every day, do not let me get famous. But, like, I love the idea of being invisible and going somewhere and meeting someone and just being like, don't tell me your name. Shh, just let me have this moment with you, please. Because, like, I'm feeling uh-huh. this. Whatever this is, I'm feeling it and I want to do this. But then it runs into the real life conundrum of, like, okay, but now what? And I'm like, nothing. Now what? Nothing. Just, like, let us experience it. But there is – that's one part of Brittany. But then there's, like, the realistic, like, very efficient, organized adult part of Brittany. And she's mm-hmm. the loudest. Ultimately, she's like, hey, you need to be responsible with what you're doing. And you need to consider people's feelings. But there is that part of me that's, like, really needy for – fiery energy, but that's also, they just come in the form of toxic people sometimes, and I hate that. Do you think people can be good and hold toxic attraction chemistry but not be toxic?
You mean, like, if someone is toxic and but they're being good because they're holding away their being toxic?
Even more than that, let's say, like, you know when you're attracted to somebody and you're like, ooh, mm-hmm. it's like the fuck boy energy and he's got tattoos and muscles and you're like, oh, stay away from this, but at the same time you're like, can I find that energy in a good person? Or no, does it only come in fuckboy, like, version?
Like, the image of it. Good question. I feel like, I think as I said before, a lot of people are stereotypes. Totally. They really are. So, usually when you meet someone and they look in a certain way, they actually are that way. Right. And it sucks, but it is the way it is. And I wouldn't judge that, like, too quick, because I would want to try to talk to them. But then I realized this person is exactly what they look like.
Yeah.
It's almost weird. Have you ever met someone that looks like a person they used to know? Like, very, very, like, they're very.
Yes.
Like, they look the same way and then they act the same way too.
Totally. That's why I think we're tropes. I think we are cookie, like, I think we are individuals.
Yeah.
But I also think we're kind of like all like other people, like our tropes.
So, I'm just wondering, like, have people treated that person the same way as the other person just because of what they look like?
Totally. It has to.
Like, or something like that. Or something, because there's like, they look the same way and they act the same way too. What?
I think so. It's very strange, I think that's why people, have you ever met those people that like have a type and they date the same type? So like I always joke, I do have a type. I'm like, oh, I just like bisexual nerdy people or bisexual like sex workers or bisexual nerdy boys or bisexual. Like I like very specific kinds of boys and girls. Like they're always the same. Mm-hmm. And I always say I have a type. And at the same time, I've been with many kinds of people temporarily because you can when you're open or explore, like you can mm-hmm. explore different
humans. You want to try something else, yeah.
Yeah, like cause I want, you know, I want to get to know certain people in certain ways. And I find mm-hmm. that sex or slash intimacy, because it doesn't even have to be sex, girl. BDSM, I don't even have sex in my BDSM. It's just that power exchange, that energy exchange with somebody. Intimacy, being naked with someone, pressing your boobs up against the back of somebody is like, the energy is so unique. Like, mm-hmm. it's just so different. But you have to, okay, let me say it like this, because it's going to sound crazy and narcissistic, so bear with me, okay?
Uh-huh.
My ego is one in which I'm self-aware enough that I feel like I can know what a stranger needs without them telling me for the most part. Mm-hmm. And just enough, it's just a surface level stuff, girl, but just enough for them to go, oh, and then you go, yes, okay, let me like use you in a good way and I'll give you what you need. And in turn, I'm going to get what I need, which is like the satisfaction of giving you what you need. But the irony is that it feels very orchestrated. So therefore like narcissistic or selfish. Have you ever had those moments where like you are kind of like, they think we're doing something, but we're actually doing something else. But to them, you are. Do you know what I'm saying?
Can you explain that one more time?
Yeah. You ever had sex with someone and they're like, we're having sex. This is great. Sex happened. But in your head, you're like, oh, not only did sex happen, girl, but I got you to be vulnerable. You're having a moment with me. I'm seeing you. I'm learning from you. Like they're just getting sex out of it. But you're getting like.
So I think that happens. I think that happens a lot.
Talk to me about that.
Yeah. But I do. I'm trying to always figure out if they are having a similar experience to me where they're looking for all the other things, too.
Yes.
But I feel like either they don't or they're trying to hide that fact and they're just trying to make it about sex. I can't really tell which one it is. It's really hard to tell.
Yes.
That's something I gotta like figure out by time. Is like, does this person like see all the other parts that comes with this or is it just about sex?
Yes.
Usually I just try to like see how they're acting. So if I can tell that they're talking a lot, I think they're having a good experience. Because they're just talking and talking and talking and talking and talking.
Yeah.
But they don't really ask me questions. They just talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. So I'm assuming that they're probably just like, it feels so nice for you to be here because I can use you for sex and as a therapist.
Yes.
Which is not bad. It's just like, you know, the way it is.
You know what they say, like sex workers. Oh my God, I did it again. Sex workers, hairstylists and like barbers are like mini therapists, and like your therapist is your therapist. But like sex allows vulnerability, which allows like that opportunity to actually like question, like, what am I even doing here? Like, what am I even doing here? If people are open to it though. So, okay. Would you say like casual sex is fulfilling for you?
Yeah. If it's good. If it's like, yeah, this feels good for me, or this is fun for me.
What
or
is
like
it fulfilling? I'm very horny.
It feels nice to be nobody sometimes.
Oof. Yes, girl. Love it.
It feels nice to just be nobody, and you're just being present, not being anyone. Not anyone important for anyone. Not important for yourself. You're just there, and it's just that. And that feels really good, I think. And then you leave, and then you don't like see them again, but it was nice when it lasted, and it felt nice to be invisible a little bit, kind of like that. It feels 100%. Nice to be, it feels nice to be a toy for someone and using someone as a toy, but you don't have anything really, and you're not looking for it. It just feels nice that way.
It does.
It feels like you take a step away from your reality a little bit.
Ooh, I like that actually. Do you consider it? Did you have to wrestle with being able to say that out loud? Like, did it ever like bother you that you actually did like being used in that kind of way, like in a mutual consensual way?
I think people see that as a bad thing, but I don't think it is. Isn't that just a part of existing?
I think so.
Why does that have to be bad? It feels like people tell you, like, you don't want to be used for sex. But am I not using the other person for sex too? Like,
yeah.
Like, am I not putting my, like, am I not responsible for putting myself in that situation where someone did not like me romantically, but just for sex? Sort of thing.
Yes.
I think a lot of people just see that as like a really horrifying thing, which I don't. It that feels like a culture thing or something.
It absolutely is, girl. It's a bubble as hell, girl. It's cultural. It's like there's a lot that goes into it. One of the things I get asked a lot is like, hey, do you experience like sex shame? And I was like, I left my parents' house before I had sex. I left the church. I wasn't religious. When I had sex for the first time, I was 21 and it was my decision. I like looked at him. I like picked out of a group of boys I worked with. I was like, I will this one. And he was like, great. Yeah. And I was like, cool. And like I asked, I was like, hey, does anyone want to apply to be my first sex partner as a boy? And everyone was like, oh, and like people applied for the job. It was very funny. And like everyone thought it was like all the girls did not understand what I was doing. And they're like, why don't you want to choose someone special? And I was like, I did. Someone special being my choice. Like my choice made it special enough. But I remember when I had sex for the first time, I was like, okay, lay down. Let me just do what I'm going to do. And I like put him inside me and I was like, cool. Okay, you can move now. And he was like, I just wanted to have like power in that moment, girl. I just wanted to know that like I was going to have sex for me. Because you're right. Everyone around me was telling me like boys want you to have sex. Boys want you to have threesomes. Boys want you to be gay. I'm like, you know what? I hate to tell everyone this, but I'm honestly just doing it for myself. I'm selfish and I'm doing it for me. And I want to know, like, how do you relate to that? Are you a girl that feels like you're a woman who's doing it for her? And then, you know what I mean? Do you ever think do you ever think about Steven and ever think about, like, he wants me to do this, so I'll do it even if I don't want to?
No. But I think it's because he's not as, like, sexually wild as me.
That is crazy. He needs to get on it, girl. He needs to get on it. What is he missing? He's missing out.
I just can't, like, I think he has already judged the situation, so he just hasn't allowed himself to think about things in a different way. And I know he wants to think about things like openly, and I think he is very open as a person. I know that he's tried some things and he enjoys certain things that he's tried that he didn't know that he liked, but I don't think he has fully focused on, I'm gonna go through a journey and just be so like fully focused on like trying sexual things to see what I like. I don't think he's had time or even maybe thought about that or find that important. I don't think he's found it important to do it, if that makes sense.
That's interesting.
Like there's things that I've said, like, I really want to try to do this with you. And like, there's times where I've like bought the lube for shit. And then that was 2 years ago and it just never happened, you know? But it's because he doesn't really show interest in that. So
I'm sorry. Did this man, okay. This man done bragged to me on the live stream we did where he's like, yeah, I have a really high sex drive and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, sir, I'm hearing different stories now right now. What?
I think he thinks about sex. I think he gets horny, but I think he's lazy. Maybe a little bit. I think he's a little lazy. And then I think also like, I think he can be like, if he sees someone for like a one-time thing, I think he can like have sex with that person like 3 times in a day. Like I think he can do that.
Oh, I see.
But like if the he thrill. Has that person, yeah. But usually, like if he has that person around, it's just not gonna happen because there will be something else to think about. If that makes sense. Not that he wouldn't want to. That's why I like traveling with him because I get him away from his computer, because I know that his computer is a distraction.
Yeah.
Like things to happen. But that's why it's good to have an open relationship, because I can get that from, like, I can get, like, the crazy stuff from other people, right?
Yeah.
But I know it's going to be, I'm never going to be able to, like go to a sex club with him. I don't think that's going to happen. I don't think he would be interested.
Girl.
But I know I can do that with other people, right? That
I was going to say, I want to see what Miami has to offer. We should go. Like, it'll be so fun. Yeah,
I have no idea. I don't know anyone that's, like, super interested in it.
I will Google. That's what I do. Every state I go to, I'm like, BDSM dungeon, sex dungeon, what is going on in this place? Uh-huh.
Yeah.
I hear like
you're gonna come.
Let's go, because like that would be so fucking fun. That's what I'm saying. I'm sorry. I'm gonna say this out loud, and I know it doesn't sound sexist, but it's not. But I swear, men talk such a big game about having high sex drives and being sexually adventurous, and then when I get with them, they're like can't keep up or slash like get lazy, and I stay in shape to literally continue having better sex, because my cardio girl, like if I'm on top, that's a lot of work.
I think a lot of people that you meet are not very driven about, like, I think they think they are, but then they meet someone that actually is. And I think we might be people that are more like a little bit more wild and crazy, and we're like really like seeking out like the experience. I think for him is like, if he masturbates like 5 times a day, that's like high sex drive. And it kind of is for like a normal person.
Yeah.
But he's not like into like the like experiencing like stuff for I don't think he really is.
I'm so sorry.
But he's all right. Like he is probably horny, but I think I might be more. I think I'm worse.
I swear women are. Sure. I swear. I'm like convinced at this point. Uh-huh. Like, you know how they talk about lesbians get bed death? I'm like, y'all, I don't know how this happens, but I just don't know. Because for me, I've never slow down. Actually, all of my male partners have literally complained in some way. Like, my last partner said, he's like, you make me feel like an object. I was like, why? And he's like, because you want to have sex with me every day. I was like, why am I in this relationship, sir? Like, I'm so confused. Like, why am I dating you? And why would we live together if, like, I can't have maybe it is objectify, because he was obsessed with computers. And I was like, I just want to grab you when I want you, and I want you to just, like, let's go. Like, what are you doing? Like, what's that? Because for me, I'm the opposite, where my job is beautiful and I love being on the internet, but my real life is happening offline. All my adventures, all my intimacy, all the cool stuff I want to do with people. Like, girl, I don't even need to bring a phone with me. Like, I just don't care about documenting it. I just want to be in the moment and, like, live it to the fullest. So afterwards, I can, like, remember and have fun and, like, be intimate with people. But that's, like, a living for you. That's, like what do you want? Like, I love people. Maybe that's just because we're girls. Like, girls do love people and guys like things. So maybe it's just like that way. I don't know. It just feels like
I think it has to do with I think we're more allowed to be weak and emotional and vulnerable than guys. I think guys are very scared of that. But it's not their fault. It's just like how it is, right? Like, that's like what you learn. You're not supposed to show emotions or like be this way. Totally. Right? So even if they wanted to be more emotional and more vulnerable, it's going to be really hard for them to do it just because it's so deep in there.
Yeah.
So I think that could be the case, maybe. That's why we're like a little bit more seeking and stuff like that. I think that could be the case for sure. Like in like for emotional stuff, yeah.
Absolutely. Especially with experiment, even with orientation, like I've had the luxury of being like very experimental with my orientations, like going around and sleeping with people and like being with boys and girls and non-binary people or whatever I wanted, because it's just allowed me that opportunity. I get judged less for it. But I also noticed that, like, okay, so I haven't been with like many straight men. I'm trying to think of like the last straight guy I was with. It's been a while. And I tend
you're lucky. I can't find bisexual guys.
Girl,
it's impossible.
It is hard out here, but I don't find myself attracted to straight men, mostly because they're not as open or adventurous, because they can't be. Yeah. There's just like a lot of walls, and I'm all about it. If they want me to break down a wall, I will be happy to facilitate that part, that process. But it really takes them being vulnerable, which is why I'm private, I think, about the things that I'm doing with people, because I want them to feel safe to let go. Because they're not going to let go if they think I'm going to make a video about it 2 weeks later. You know what I mean? And they're not going to let go if they feel like I'm going to talk shit on them. I want people to feel comfortable, because you have one fucking life, girl. And then you're all going to just be incinerated and die. Like, that's it. Like, our souls are going to leave our body or whatever they're doing. Who knows what's happening? And we're all going to die. So I couldn't imagine living my one life. Like, have you ever used a strap-on? Like, on anyone, boys or girls? Yes.
Girl, not guy.
Okay, on a girl, not a guy. For me, like, the dream is to, like, peg a guy for sure. Like, that's 100% a dream. Like, I want to fuck a guy so bad. And I remember I had this opportunity one time, and this beautiful man, like, beautiful. Like, out of all the, like, fucking weird girls, he was like, that one. I was like, me? And then, like, I got so excited. And then he, like, bailed on me, girl, after negotiating, after getting so excited, after being hot and heavy. And I'm like, why would you do this to me? And he was just like, he couldn't even answer me. He, like, ghosted me and saw me at the club and, like, would just ignore me. And I'm like, hey. What the fuck? And I'm very confrontational where I'm like, just tell me so we can either fix it or move on. Yeah, because the thing is like, I see these as like moments in time, like truly just moments, girl. Like this moment right here, it's just a moment in time. We're going to get off this computer and go do whatever we're going to do. And it's like, oh yeah, we did that thing the other day. Like we had a real experience, you know? And I wish people would know that there is, but you know what? In their defense, it must be very scary to meet women who don't need anything from them.
I think so, because it kind of like, it's like almost like a power thing, right?
Yeah. Maybe that's why they can't be vulnerable, because we have nothing, because I assume when you're with these people, like you don't need money, you don't need access to things, like you're independent. I
like spoiling people. I'm like the one that is like, let me spoil you sort of thing. Yeah. And I think they like it, but they get nervous. Yes. I think they're like, oh, that's kind of nice. Like, you know, when you ask a guy a straight up question, it's so honest and just so like, just like... How do you want things to be? Do you want to do this? Do you want to do that? And they're like, oh, yeah, that could be nice. But it's not an answer. And it's not really like a yes or no. It's just kind of like, I think you're saying yes, but you're also like a little nervous or like a little scared. Yes. So I need to like, okay. And then I just tell them like, okay, I'll get some more time to get to know you to see what you actually said, because you're not telling me anything right now.
Yes, like,
You're not showing me an answer right now. Yeah.
What do you do when people are like... because I get nervous, girl, about like moving forward with people that are kind of like not tell. Okay, I was with this girl once, and she legit, I was like, what do you like? It was me and another guy and a girl, and we were focused on her. And I said, hey, like, what do you want from me? And she goes, she buries her, like, she gets on her stomach on the bed and buries her face in her hands. And she goes, I don't know. And I was like, okay, but like, you have to tell me what you need, because I'm just going to do something to you. And then you're going to be like, oh my God, Brittany violated me. Like, what do you need? And she was like, I don't know. And I was like, do you want me to touch you? And she goes, maybe. And I was like, maybe is not an answer. Like, I need you to know. So the next time we were together, I told her, I was like, if you want to have sex with me or be with me vulnerably, I need you to give me like blanket consent, or tell me like these are the things that are off limits so I can work with what's on the limit. Because she wasn't able, she got so scared, like with her own desires, with her own wants, that she couldn't verbalize them, and she would like freeze, which is like not very good when we're talking about like consent violations. Like, I'm trying not to violate you, girl, and it's like I can't read your mind. But at the same time, I kind of want I want to know someone so well that even if that happens, I can be what they need in that moment in order for me to get what I need in that moment, which I think is their vulnerability. I think ultimately that is what I want from people, is I want their vulnerabilities a little bit. I might be a witch. I might carry like people's vulnerabilities in a purse, but like I kind of do want to collect them.
Because it's real. Like, when you're being vulnerable, you're being the most, like, yourself the absolute most, I think.
Yes.
I think so, yeah. It's, like, the deepest part of yourself, like, the nastiest, dirtiest, like, the most weakest part of yourself. I mean, if you show that to someone, that's, like, that's you right there.
But then here's the question, I guess. If you're telling me, like, has anyone seen those parts of you?
Let me think. I really think it was when I was with my friend and I had that really, really bad day.
Yeah.
And I felt embarrassed, and I just felt like, I'm supposed to be strong for everyone, and now I'm like I need help. Like I'm fucking, just, I'm going crazy right now. And she is just here, and I feel so bad for her for sitting here listening. But she wanted to be there,
of course.
And I could feel that she wanted, like she wanted to. So that felt really nice. But I definitely felt like you feel so bad, right?
Yeah.
And like so shit, and you're supposed to have, you know, like you're supposed to have everything under control, and then I absolutely didn't. But she was there, and like she was there after too. She was, yeah, and that was great. That was super, super nice. Not like, trying to think. I do like to get really messy during sex. I think that's really fun. Like I like to look fucking nasty and gross. I like to hear how shitty I am. Like I like that.
Yeah.
That's nice. But it's almost like a power thing for me. It's almost like, yeah, I can take this much. And like I can do all of this, and I can be this gross, and I can be like this shitty, and like I could look this unattractive.
Yeah.
And this person still wants me, I guess. And this that's really, I think that's really fun. Or this person did this to me. I think that's really fun. No, I don't know. I don't think a lot of normal people are trying to seek that from people. I think I don't think so. I don't think that that's what people really go for. I think it's hard to find.
Well, okay, so there's two questions that are coming to mind, girlfriend. So the first one, of course, is like, are you like a strong woman trope where like you want to give up power and so like you want to do it in this way, but you're secretly still topping from the bottom?
Does it make sense to like the idea of like almost being abused and like really just like, you're like, you're so, you're doing stuff that you kind of don't want to, but you want to do it because it makes you feel so, like, it makes you feel good.
Yeah.
And it makes you feel really powerful that you're able to go that far into something that you did not want to.
Totally.
But this sounds very crazy for a lot of people, because why the fuck would you want all these things? But it's like, I want that because it makes me fucking scared, or this is like really uncomfortable, but I really like it, sort of thing, I guess.
Yes. Well, most people want safety, and most people want control, but out of fear. And I feel like you want safety and control, and maybe I'm projecting a little bit, but I feel like you want it more because when you're a powerful, independent woman who needs no man slash anybody really, but you do need, what you need to is be seen. And like to have those moments is to be like, for maybe a moment, the vulnerable one in the situation, and like therefore open, and therefore almost like after, maybe they'll even take care of you like with aftercare, and that'd be kind of nice. But like, call me a whore for the next hour, just, you know, but then after this, like reassure me that you don't actually want to abuse me. And I'm like,
yeah, you know, it's like you're living in the idea of it, but it is very, very real. But then you're having like the real conversation, you know, like, okay, yeah, this is how it is. Yeah.
Yes. Like I almost want to be, I call it like, I almost want you to fuck me up just a little bit mentally, where I almost doubt for a second that this isn't like.
Yes. Yeah. Absolutely. Like you could kill me if you wanted to right now.
Exactly.
Sort of thing. Like you could do that, but you're not. And that's a bonding experience. And that's probably why I like jiu-jitsu as well. Because you get in control over people, and then you get controlled by people, and they could kill you or break something if they wanted to, but they don't.
Yes.
So it's like and you're really, really close. Right?
It's a trust exercise.
Mm-hmm.
It's exactly.
I really like that.
Are you looking for different interactions that will allow you to build trust with people, even if it's temporary?
Yeah, I think so. It's just fun. It's like a fun thing to do. It makes you feel. It's nice. It's a really, really nice feeling.
Yeah.
It's almost like being on a drug, because you're getting like terrified, or you're feeling something really, really strongly. It's almost like watching a movie, a little bit, right?
Yes, yeah. Absolutely. Uh-huh. Okay.
It's so, entertainment. Yeah.
It is entertainment, and it's like so fulfilling. I know, I guess for me, like what I feel like is human. I feel alive. I feel adrenaline. It's like what I feel like when I jump out of a plane. I just like, I love it. Mm-hmm. That like free falling moment where you're like, holy fuck, what am I doing? What am I doing? What am I doing? What am I doing? Oh, wait, there's a parachute.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And so you're kind of like, okay, but I love feeling like, I love roller coasters. I've had like BDSM wise, I've had like needles in my thighs. I've been like hung upside down. I've like done all these crazy things where I'm like pushing myself in order to feel, but I'm also looking for something. And I, like you said, it's hard to verbalize like what you're looking for, but I know.
I think it's being present. I think that's it. I think it's being present. Yeah. Right. Because, like, when you're feeling pain, or when you're feeling, like, when something is really scary or just really intense or just really insane, that's like when you are really, really, really present.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I can't turn off my brain otherwise.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Because you're always thinking about work or something or responsibilities or being in control or like, oh, do I have to save this person's emotions? But like, sex and BDSM are the only times my brain ever turns off. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, I'm always just like thinking, going to bed is so hard for me. Like, I wish I could just sleep, but my brain's like, and it's just thinking about all the things. But like, when you're present in a moment, it feels exactly like that. It feels like a moment in time. Like, literally everything around me is frozen. And I'm just like alive right now. How much, and again, don't share anything you don't want to, girlfriend, but like, how physically destructive are you open to being in physical intimate relationships? Like, has anyone ever slapped you or anyone ever consensually ever like choked you or anything like that?
Yeah.
How do you feel about those moments?
I really like it, for sure. And it might be the case, like, when I'm in it, I'm like, how do I say it? Not like struggling, but I definitely feel like there's no way out of this. If I just like felt like I can, like I have to leave, I can't. I just have to be in it, and I'm forced to like enjoy it.
Yes.
And it sounds really insane to say to like to a normal person that doesn't understand this, because it sounds like you're raping yourself.
Right.
But it's like, it is like you're enjoying it, but you're also not enjoying it, but you are. And then afterwards you feel really, 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 really good.
Really good.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I think that's how it is. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, this is have you heard of the YouTuber Carl Benjamin Sarganavakad? I think he's talked to Steven in the past, but him and I know each other from parts of our internet time together, and one of the things he always said that really stuck out to me is that he said that like women love rape fantasies, and maybe it's a part of them wants to be raped. And now I've been assaulted, and I will say like, you know what wasn't fun about the assault was like I wasn't a participant in it.
Yeah,
because what happens in assault is what happens during sex. It's just sex and intimacy, but it's not I wasn't invited in. I wasn't even a part of my own moment. So that's why I was so annoyed with it, versus like these consent, non-consent, these CNC things we're talking about is like we have consented to not consenting. And so what it allows is us to do things that basically are what you would call rape, but they're not rape because literally the consent is there.
Yeah. Exactly.
And that's like the safety point. And I assume you use safe words or something. It's something where you could turn it off if you really needed
also,
to.
Yeah, but you're also almost, you're making your, like you're putting yourself in an uncomfortable position.
Yes.
But you're enjoying it, but it's really uncomfortable. Yeah. So it is like, it's like, I don't like this, but I like that I don't like this.
Yeah.
A lot more than I don't like this. So yes. You're just like, really like, I do want to do this. Yeah.
Yeah. I always tell my partners. Yeah. I tell my partners like, look, I want to generally, this is the feeling I'm looking for, but I also want to see what happens naturally, like you said earlier. It's like, I want to see what happens, but with the right energy, you can go to places that it's like, like, and here's the problem is I don't get to have it often. So when I do, my brain's just like, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, it's happening, it's happening, it's happening. We're having like chemistry connection. And it's like, holy shit. Like, okay, one time I was doing, and tell me if any of my stories are getting too TMI. But this one's pretty tame. So I was hanging out with this couple and I was like bottoming, submissive for them. I was like on my knees with a collar, like submissive on a pillow, female dom, male submissive, me submissive. So the female dom would do things like, okay, Brittany, I'm going to give you a test. And I'm like, okay, she'd be like, here is a bucket full of beans. There's 72 beans in here. And I was like, okay. And she goes, okay, ready? And I'm like, yeah. And they're dry beans. And she tosses them to the floor and she goes, find them all in 30 seconds or you'll be punished. And I was like, what? What? And I'm like, not a perfectionist at all, but I want to perform well. So I'm such a bottom bitch that I'm like, okay. Yes. So like, I'm looking for all these beans and I put them all down and I'm like, I think I found them all. She goes, did you? She starts counting. She goes, there is not enough beans here. And I'm like, there are not enough beans here. And I started to panic because I couldn't find any more beans. Come to find out, there were never 72 beans. There was less than 72 beans. So no matter how hard I worked, I was never going to find all the beans because they weren't there. She tricked me. And it was the greatest satisfaction I had of like, and I felt so fucked over in such a good way. And then she put this nipple, you know how the nipple clamps will have like the clamps and then the chains? Well, she used one on my nose and hit me right on this. She was a doctor. She hit me right on this nerve that instantly made me cry. I couldn't even see, girl. She goes, get on your knees and you're getting snot all over my toys. And I was snotting everywhere. It was disgusting. I just like was gross. And she was like, walk on your knees to the kitchen sink and wash my toys right now that you're getting dirty with all of your snot. And I was like, and I couldn't find my way around her stupid house because I hadn't really, I didn't know it very well. And I'm like blindly going through her house on my knees, crying and snotting. And all I was thinking was, man, I feel so attractive right now.
Yeah.
I feel so good right now. Yeah. And I just like, I bet if anyone was seeing it happen, they'd be like, what? This girl's being tortured. I'm like, in the best way possible. She would like do very interesting things where like she was really good with a whip. Mm-hmm. And she would like literally whip your clit to a beat of a song. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, bro, like I'm feeling sensations in my body that I don't think anyone's ever felt. Or like even meeting women at the dungeon that like make special hot sauces to put on your clit. And I'm just sitting here like, I am hanging out with the weirdest humans ever. And at the same time, they're not even that weird, I swear. I swear they're like normal people outside the dungeon. And that blows my mind how many versions of ourselves we can be.
Absolutely.
Oh, it's so good though. How many versions of Melina do you think exist like in that kind of realm, like thinking about it that way?
I don't know because I haven't had enough people trying to trigger that out of me. As I said, everyone is making it about themselves when they're with me. So then I never really get to like
explore.
Like I try to, yeah, I try to explore. I try to seek that, but it's really hard with most people to try to do something like that.
Yeah.
I think. But when I do find someone that wants to do things with me, I'm very like, hey, let's do this. Like, let's try this. I want to do that and this and this and this and this. But a lot of people don't know what they want either. So it's really hard to work with them because I might know what I want.
Yeah.
But they don't know and they don't really know how to figure out like, what I like, even if I'm saying it straight up to them, they don't really trust me on it.
Yeah.
That's also the thing.
Are these normally... So
I think I've just been unlucky.
Mm-hmm. Are these normally, like, vanilla people?
Maybe some, but not all of them. I can tell that some of them are, like, really not vanilla, but they just haven't had the experience to explore that, and they don't really dare to, but I can tell that they want to. But they don't dare to. They don't have the courage to do it.
Yeah. Yes. Okay, so I'm curious then, have you never interacted with an energy that is like, knows what they want, is a dominant slash a top, and can just absolutely take you there?
I don't think so. And even if they acted like they did, I don't think they do. I think they just try to make it look like they do.
Yep. Yeah. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think that's like usually, I think I've been... Yeah, I think it's something like that. But as I said before, like, I don't know anyone that can get me into it. So I just haven't really, you know, but I could if I wanted to, I could. I just haven't.
What does that mean?
I think I'm.
If I wanted
like,
to, I could.
As I said before, like, I could try to Google things up and like try to find something on my own. I could do that. I could do a mushroom trip alone too. It just hasn't come to the point where I've done it.
Interesting. You know? Okay.
And I think I probably put the responsibility of like, finding someone that will lead me into this because I need someone to guide me. But I can tell, like, I haven't found anyone that can guide me.
Yeah, so why the need for the guide? Tell me about that. What is that part of your brain that needs that guide?
It feels nice to have someone being in control over you and also that can kind of take care of you.
Yeah.
And it feels nice to, like, it's almost like finding a Gandalf. Like, knowing that Gandalf exists feels nice. Because you're always, like, really, like, sure that everything will be okay.
Yeah.
Sort of thing. And you don't really know about yourself because you have no idea what the fuck the universe is, right? So you don't really know if everything will be okay. But I think what you have to do is that you have to find the confidence in yourself. You have to find your own Gandalf and, like, be your own. I think it's more about that than, like, trying to find someone. And I think like, the past few years I've tried to, like, find someone to put that responsibility on.
Yeah.
But I haven't been able to find it. I feel like people have come to me being a Gandalf for them instead.
Yes.
So what I have to do is that I have to put time on myself to find the Gandalf in me and then be confident enough to go out and do stuff, I guess. That's probably it.
Okay, so now I got to ask then, because this is perfect. Mm-hmm. Yes, 1,000%. Like, I feel the same way, like, ditto, like, legit. Like, I'm the mommy trope. Like, I'm a mom. I take care of everybody. Like, even my own family members, like, I get called all the time. Like, Brittany, do something. I'm like, okay. And, like, my life, my dating life, everything, where... I've always wondered, like, why that was, but I think a big part of it is that. It's like, well, if no one else is going to step up, like, you have to automatically do it because you're capable. But I think, like, women have this – okay, so then I have to ask because, like, I think Stephen said the same thing to me. And, again, I'm so interested in, like, again, like, romance and dating and why people choose the people they choose. But girlfriend, mm-hmm. you both have told me the same thing. And I find that fascinating. Do you guys need a mediator, like a third person who can come in and like mix your energies together, like in a potion? Because I'll do that. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. I feel like you guys need like a connector, like a, oh, like, yeah. a wire to yeah. be like plug into him and be like, guys. Because like, yeah. how do you both want and desire the same things? Because he said the same thing where he feels like a need to always be the top and take care of the situation. And he uh-huh. rarely feels like someone can do it. So like, you know what I mean? You guys are switches, basically.
Do you mean like when we're hanging out together, who is like in control of the situation?
Hanging out or like even being with each other?
I think we are both on the same thing.
Yeah.
I think so because we're both a little similar. I think the similarity with us is that we're pretty like independent people, but in different ways. And we're very like dominant and we're like, we act like the main character. I don't think we act like a side character. So we both are very, very similar in that way.
Even when
and
you're together?
Don't, like, yeah, I think so.
Okay.
I think so. But like sometimes, as I said before, like when we trip and stuff, it kind of like becomes automatically about him. But it feels like, it's becoming that way because when we are tripping and when we're doing emotional things, he is the one that needs to explore more than I do because I kind of already have figured things out emotionally and he hasn't as much. Maybe, or maybe he has, but he hasn't been able to express it. So when he's high or when he's vulnerable, he wants to talk a lot. Like he wants to talk about like what he's thinking about. And it's great for me because it's easier for me to understand him when he actually talks. Because I think usually when he's sober, he's really bad at like communicating what he's thinking and feeling.
Yeah.
But when he's on drugs, he do.
Okay. On when he's on drugs and he's monologuing, from your perspective, is he actually learning something about himself or is he just high rambling?
I think that's the moment where he talks about himself. Like, for real? Or he's like, he's talking to himself.
Oh, I think, interesting.
I think, you know, like when you, I feel like I did this when I was younger. And then I realized that it's like, I think it's okay. But I really value when people is like talking to you and talking with you. But I remember I told my friend when I was like 16 that whenever I talk to her, it feels like I'm talking to myself and not to her. So she just made me talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. And I think that usually when me and Steven are hanging out with other people, usually they're just like talking like to themselves through us. Like we're just like a therapist there, right? A little bit. But I feel like when we do drugs together, I feel like he is the one that is usually just like talking, 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 talking. And like I can talk, but I think he needs to talk because he usually doesn't and it's good for him. And even though he's like, oh, I'm fine, I don't have to talk. Or like, I don't have to talk much. I'm independent. I don't have any problems. Yeah. I think it feels good for him to do it. And that's like the time where he's allowing himself to do it, you know?
That's interesting.
Uh-huh. But not that he doesn't. Like, not that he doesn't want to talk or anything like that. I think he just feels like he doesn't have the need to it. But then like the wall is down and he feels like he wants to, I guess.
Yeah. So ultimately, am I correct in hearing that you want an opportunity to be the main character in a way where everyone's actually like listening and hearing you and seeing you, not just the main character that like distracts people?
I think I had a very interesting experience pretty recently and it was not like 100%. It was like 5% of like what I wanted, I think. Mm-hmm. And then I realized, wait, this is something I need. So I was hanging out with some strangers in a house and I took shrooms, maybe like a gram, but it was enough for me to like start like feeling like, oh wait, I have tensions that needs to be released. And I didn't know that they were there. And I told them like, hey guys, I'm going to start crying because I'm feeling something really strongly. And they were just sitting there like touching me and just like letting me cry. And it looks a little insane because it's not really like allowed to just sit and cry. And they were not really asking me anything. They were just like touching me and they were strangers, but they were there and they were like watching me cry. And it felt like they were listening to me when I was just crying because I wasn't saying anything.
Yeah.
I think that is like, so, like that made me feel seen in a certain way. Yeah. And it didn't actually really matter of what I was thinking about or like what the like, you know, like objective things that was going on that I was, it didn't really matter. It was just more that they were sitting there and just watching me cry. And that was the time that they chose to do that specific time. Mm. They took a little bit of their time in their life to do that. And that felt really nice to me. And they were not trying to like get anything from me. They were just there. They don't know me. Like, and that, like, that was really nice.
I love that, girl. That feels so powerful to me. Like, I do. I really believe in like the power of, you know, I have so many stories, but I really have to pee. Do you mind taking a 2-second break?
I need to pee as well.
Let's pee! Yeah, let's pee, Rick. We'll be right back.
Okay, be right back. Okay.